Over the last century, the world has become a much smaller place. People and ideas have traveled from continent to continent at ever greater speeds. 2 days have accelerated this revolution in mobility more than any other. The sending of the first wireless message across the Atlantic and Concorde's first transatlantic flight to New York. This is a dramatization of events as they happened on those 2 days. It is 1901. On the Isle of Wight, Queen Victoria dies at the age of 81. In Nice, Gottlieb Daimler builds his first Mercedes automobile. Rioters set St. Petersburg alight during a protest against Tsarist rule. And in St. John's, Newfoundland, the world is about to wake up to the power of wireless. December 1901. The world lives in almost total radio silence. With electromagnetic waves virtually unknown to science, radio, television, and mobile phones haven't even been dreamt of. The preferred method of long-distance mobile communication is by carrier pigeon. But one of the greatest amateur inventors of all time is set on changing all that. Guglielmo Marconi is obsessed by one goal, something that no one else believes will ever be possible: to send a wireless message 150 times further than anyone else in history, 1,800 miles across the Atlantic Ocean. Poldhu, Cornwall, home to what's been dubbed the Thunder Factory. Inside is experimental electrical equipment designed by Marconi for his grand enterprise. It's 100 times more powerful than anything ever built. Today, this equipment will be pressed into service for a unique experiment. Chief Engineer William Entwistle has received a telegram from his boss, Marconi. Riviera is a secret code word. It's the instruction for Poldhu to start transmitting electromagnetic signals from 3 p.m. Entwistle has exactly 4.5 hours to make sure all the machinery is ready. When the transmission begins, 20,000 volts of electricity will leap between the two brass spheres of the spark gap. This exact moment, 1,800 miles across the Atlantic, Newfoundland is waking up. In the luxurious Cochrane Hotel, one of the guests is hoping to change history by being the first to harness the power of this mysterious new medium known as electromagnetic radio waves. They were discovered in 1886 by the German physicist Heinrich Hertz. Since then, the race has been on to profit from them commercially. In France, Eugène Ducreté has sent a wireless message over 2 miles from the Eiffel Tower to the roof of the Pantheon. In Germany, Professor Slaby has sent a signal over 13 miles. Marconi is desperate not to be overtaken by his rivals. But he makes an unlikely challenger to the luminaries of the scientific establishment. The son of an Irish mother and an Italian father, he has almost no formal education, but he's been obsessed with wireless since he was 8. At 22, he was still conducting experiments in his parents' attic in Italy. At 25, he sent a message 30 miles across the English Channel. Now, aged 27, he's gambling everything on what he calls his great experiment.
Yes? Good morning, Mr. Marconi. Thought you might want to read this.
Thank you, Mr. Kemp.
George Kemp is what Marconi has called his first assistant, collaborator and friend.
Third page, top left.
2 days ago, the first ever Nobel Prize has been awarded for brilliance in physics. Marconi knows that the hours ahead could also bring him fame and fortune.
Some of the members of the royal family now at Stockholm.
Or they may lead to scientific ridicule and financial ruin.
The mere memory of it makes me shudder. To me, it was a question of the life and death of my future.
Marconi's already in the public eye. He's been nicknamed by the press the Wonderful Wizard of Wireless.
Any indication about the weather?
His experiments have been funded through family connections. His mother belongs to the Jameson family, makers of Irish whiskey. Their friends have backed Marconi heavily.
In the coming days, heavy storms are expected, occasioning a potential danger to shipping.
It would appear the weather is against us.
From Marconi's hotel on the Newfoundland coast, it's a short walk to the location he's chosen for his experiment. High on a cliff overlooking the Atlantic is Signal Hill. It was here that the first successful telegraph cable connecting Britain with the American continent had been laid in 1866. 35 years on, Marconi's dream is to make long-distance communication wireless. Disregarding conventional opinion, Marconi is convinced that radio waves can somehow travel beyond the horizon. Unlike his contemporaries, he has an instinctive grasp of their practical potential.
These waves might furnish mankind with a new and powerful means of communication, utilizable not only across continents and seas, but also on board ships, bringing with it a vast diminution of the dangers of navigation.
...1800 miles across the Atlantic, it's less than 2 hours before the transmission begins. Blasting an electromagnetic signal such a distance will require enormous power. To achieve this, an oil engine has been connected to an industrial alternator capable of generating 25 kilowatts of electricity. Marconi hopes this will be enough to make the wireless signals leap across the Atlantic to where he and Kemp are waiting in Newfoundland. Marconi has set up his receiving station in an abandoned barracks on Signal Hill. Over in Cornwall, transmitting the wireless signals may require 20,000 volts. But here in Newfoundland, Marconi's attempt to receive those signals will rely on just 12 volts of batteries. Marconi has brought across with him state-of-the-art Edwardian equipment. Part of the system is a device to detect radio waves, known as a coherer. Marconi designed it in Italy when he was 21. If a Morse signal is picked up by the aerial outside, it will pass through the coherer, completing an electric circuit. Once the signal has passed through, Marconi has come up with a primitive, if effective, way of breaking the circuit again. His system will then be ready to receive another dot or dash. Marconi's assistant, Kemp, is also a wireless expert. Before joining Marconi in 1896, he'd been in the Navy as an electrical and torpedo instructor. While serving in the North Atlantic, he also learned how to keep out the winter chills.
All seems to be in order. Thank you, Mr. Kemp. Could you check the inker for me, please?
The Morse inker is crucial to Marconi's experiment. Transmissions from Cornwall will start in less than 2 hours' time. If Marconi picks up any signals, the Morse tape will provide hard evidence of his success. Marconi's desktop equipment is now prepared to receive signals later this morning. But his obsessive preparations for the day have been going on for months.
Here's the problem, is with this pole here. Of course,
3 months earlier, Marconi is on the other side of the Atlantic in Cornwall. The outcome of his experiment will depend on one thing above all else: his design for the transmitting aerial. He's arrived at its dimensions by trial and error.
I cannot understand why the scientists do not see this thing as I do. It is perfectly simple and depends merely on the height of wire used. We found several years ago that if we doubled the height of our aerial wire, we quadrupled the effect.
But the scale of his ambition is completely unprecedented. He's determined to send a signal 150 times further than anyone else before him. To stand any chance of success, an aerial of appropriate proportions will be needed. His design for a ring of masts is nearing completion. 200 feet up, riggers are lashing the remaining masts into place. Marconi has been warned that his masts are structurally unsound. But he's pressing on regardless. Any delay could result in being overtaken by one of his rivals. But in his haste, Marconi has overlooked one unavoidable feature of Cornish life: the Atlantic weather. Just hours after his inspection, a violent storm brews over the Atlantic. Marconi has ignored warnings that the aerial has insufficient guy ropes securing it. And he's about to discover if these warnings have been justified. Marconi's ambitions lie in ruins.
For some days, I had visions of my experiment having to be postponed for several months or longer. And then I decided that it might be possible to make a preliminary trial with a simpler aerial.
To get this far has taken Marconi unwavering determination. He's not about to give up now. He gives Kemp orders to salvage what he can from the wrecked masts. Testing his engineering skills to the full, Kemp sets to work on his boss's new design. Within a week, the salvaged aerial is ready. Marconi can now finalize his travel plans to cross the Atlantic. At the end of November, Marconi finally sets sail from Liverpool to Newfoundland. He's still deeply uncertain of the outcome of his experiment, so he's decided to keep its true nature a closely guarded secret.
A moment of your time, Mr. Marconi, please.
Certainly.
May I ask, Is it true, as some have conjectured, that you are intending to send radio waves across the Atlantic?
Not in the least. I have never suggested such an idea. And, though the feat may be accomplished someday, it has yet hardly been thought here.
Thank you, sir.
A well-publicized failure would expose Marconi to ridicule from the scientific establishment, who scoff at his mad wireless dreams.
Got that, didn't you?
The press doesn't quite know what to make of the young inventor.
Though a purely Italian name, there is nothing of the foreigner in Mr. Marconi's appearance. His speech is that of an educated scientific Englishman, and his dress and general manner are those of a pleasant young English gentleman.
To justify his trip to Newfoundland, Marconi has fabricated a cover story.
Leaving our shores again, sir?
Officially, he'll merely be conducting short-range wireless tests from ship to shore. His baggage raises no suspicions.
Thank you.
But its contents are hardly those typical of a travelling Edwardian gentleman.
Reception instruments.
Aerial wire.
If word gets out about what's inside, the young inventor fears he'll be written off by many as a crank.
Two balloons.
Hydrogen gas.
But it's not just Marconi's reputation that's at stake. It's his finances, too.
My experiment involved risking at least £50,000 to achieve a result which had been declared impossible by some of the principal mathematicians of the time.
Almost nothing is known to science about how radio waves work. They seem to have magical properties and have been shown to travel through air, wood, and even stone and metal. Marconi is as baffled as everyone else as to how they do this. One of Marconi's rivals, a professor of electricity at Oxford University, is even convinced that radio waves may be used to communicate with the dead. The scientific establishment believes that transmitting radio waves across the Atlantic is impossible. But that's exactly what Marconi is intending to do. It's thought that radio waves behave just like light waves. And everyone knows that light waves travel in straight lines. They don't follow the curve of the Earth's surface, but disappear off into space. Because of the Earth's curvature, there's effectively a wall of water 100 miles high between Britain and Newfoundland. Marconi has no idea whether radio waves actually travel through water or skim across its surface. But he's not a scientist, he's an inventor. And he's got an overwhelming hunch that somehow his signals will make it across. Sixteen days later, Marconi has arrived in Newfoundland. It's the day of transmission, and he's still struggling to pick up a signal from Cornwall. He's devised a unique way of raising his aerial hundreds of feet into the air to improve reception. He'll be using a kite. The Levito kite is the British Army's latest secret weapon. It's the brainchild of Colonel Robert Baden-Powell. He claims that a stack of his kites can lift a volunteer soldier hundreds of feet into the air. This would give commanders a bird's eye view of the enemy's position in battle. Rather than carrying human cargo, Marconi is intending to trail his receiving aerial made of copper wire 500 feet long. Thank you. at this precise moment with 11 minutes to go, William Entwistle prepares his team for transmission. One of the workers recalled,
"We all put cotton wool in our ears to lessen the force of the electric concussion, which was not unlike the successive explosions of the Maxim gun."
Critical moment has come, for which I have been preparing for 6 years, in which I have faced numerous kinds of criticism and attempts to discourage me and turn me from my ultimate purpose.
In Cornwall, Entwistle's orders from Marconi are to transmit the letter S from exactly 3 o'clock. In Morse code, S is made up of 3 dots.
Circuit stable. Check.
Tapping out even this simplest of signals puts a huge strain on the power plant. A worker at Poldhu remarked,
"When the door of the enclosure was opened, the roar of the discharge could be heard for miles along the coast. This smashing discharge was noteworthy. Every metal gutter, drainpipe, or object on the site resonated freely."
Another one gone.
How many have we got left?
2.
32 minutes into the broadcast from Cornwall, Marconi still hasn't heard anything. Of his 6 kites, 4 have now been lost. In Cornwall, dusk is already falling. Another kite has been launched and is in the air, but Marconi's Morse inker has still not been activated. He is totally isolated and has no way of contacting Cornwall to see whether anything's wrong at their end.
Tell your man to keep the kite steady. Tell your man to keep the kite steady.
The coherer Marconi designed in Italy 6 years before is still receiving no signals. He makes a difficult decision: to abandon his own coherer and to try a mercury coherer instead. This new coherer is more sensitive, but it has one major drawback. It's not compatible with the Morse printer. Marconi will have to rely on his hearing alone.
The receiver on the table before me was very crude. I placed a single earphone on my ear and started listening.
But the change of coherer makes no difference. Poldhu has been blasting out dots for an hour.
camp. Can you hear anything, Mr. Kemp?
Yes, I think I can. Three dots.
For the first time in history, a radio signal is bridging two continents.
The electric waves which were being sent out from Poldhu had traversed the Atlantic, serenely ignoring the curvature of the Earth, which so many doubters considered would be a fatal obstacle.
Time check, Mr. Kemp.
12:30 exactly.
In my earliest experiments, I had always held a belief, almost an intuition, that radio signals would someday be sent across greater distances. I now knew that all my anticipations had been justified.
We've done it.
Well done, Thames.
Marconi's predictions were soon fulfilled. His daring Newfoundland success caught the world by surprise.
May I propose a toast? To our great success.
Your ear.
Success.
Fated by the world's press, Marconi became a household name overnight. He was still just 27 years old.
If I could ask you to capture the moment for us.
Pioneering work of the man who described himself as an ardent amateur was recognized by the scientific establishment. In 1909, 8 years after the Nobel Prize was established, Marconi was awarded the prize for physics. The practical value of his equipment was dramatically proven 3 years later, when the Titanic sank just off Newfoundland. Its wireless distress signals were picked up by a nearby ship. The press credited Marconi for the 712 lives that were saved. Wireless had come of age. As the 20th century continued, the invisible web of wireless communication that Marconi started weaving spread around the world and beyond.
This is 2LO, the London station of the British Broadcasting Company calling.
I am speaking to you from the cabinet room at 10 Downing Street.
The opening program will now be repeated on the Marconi EMI system.
One small step for man.
And good morning, everyone. Welcome to the exciting new sound of Radio 1.
The Vodafone you have called has not responded.
One giant leap for mankind.
Marconi's mastery over radio waves triggered a revolution in communication. 76 years later, the world's first supersonic passenger plane beckoned a revolution in travel. But it would be travel at a price. It's 1977. In Tenerife, 574 people die as two jumbo jets collide at Las Palmas Airport. Elvis Presley is found dead at his home in Memphis, Tennessee. Egypt's President Sadat becomes the first Arab leader to make a state visit to Israel. And at Toulouse Airport, the world's fastest airliner is standing idle beside runway 15. The 17th of October, 1977, the most controversial passenger plane ever built is in the dock. The Supreme Court in Washington, D.C. is deciding whether this triumph of European technology can land at America's busiest airport. France's leading test pilot, Jean Franchi, is standing by for the most important flight of his career.
Descent.
And British Airways pilot Brian Walpole is marking time while Concorde's odds are weighed up in America. If the Supreme Court says yes, it could result in hundreds more Concordes flying commercially in the decades ahead. If it says no, the most expensive passenger plane ever built will become a museum piece overnight. Concorde has already proven its supersonic credentials. The world's most glamorous plane has flown to the most glamorous cities. But none of them will ever make it any money. Only one city has sufficient millionaires per square mile to keep Concorde in the air. It's the route Concorde's been designed for. New York. Of all the world's flights, three quarters cross the Atlantic. And of these, almost half touch down in the Big Apple. If it's to have any commercial future, Concorde needs New York. But New York doesn't want Concorde.
We're mad as hell and we're not going to take it anymore.
Thousands living under the flight path to New York's John F. Kennedy Airport are up in arms. They're highly organized, highly vocal middle-class Americans. And if they don't get their way, they've got enough clout to bring the country's busiest airport to a standstill. Spearheading the campaign to kill Concorde is Carol Berman, a 52-year-old resident of Long Island. As her campaign gains momentum, Concorde gets dragged into the dock. Official hearings assess the evidence for and against Concorde, known in America as a supersonic transport, or SST.
The building shook. I held my ears.
The SST is charged with doing everything but causing ingrown toenails, and I'll be surprised if the misinformers do not find a way to do that.
Please consider our fate carefully.
Concorde's fate has been placed in an indefinite holding pattern. The risk of Concorde losing its case becomes so great that the British government sends over its Minister for Industry.
Is that I like campaigns to present accurate facts, and this is just a hysterically inaccurate campaign.
After 19 months caught up in the American legal system, the Supreme Court makes its decision. Concorde can land at JFK.
They will fly a proving flight into JFK this coming Wednesday, the day after tomorrow. Okay, that's not going to stop it.
Aerospatiale headquarters in Toulouse is the French birthplace of Concorde. Concorde Sierra Bravo can now be readied for its historic transatlantic flight to New York. The Concorde project has been a joint investment by the British and French governments. So today's Concorde has a suitable livery. One side of the tail fin has been painted with the British Airways colors, the other with the Air France logo. The evening before they are due to take off for New York, the pilots are called to a room nearby.
What do you say to the accusation that Concorde is the noisiest commercial aircraft that's ever flown?
Well, again, I would come back to the fighter planes, which are to be counted by the thousands flying over Vietnam and over...
The pilots must train for 6 months to fly Concorde. But something they've not been prepared for is how to deal with a hostile press.
The fuel burnt by Concorde could adversely affect the weather patterns, the global...
When they get to New York, these pilots will be the human face of Concorde. Their mission will not just be to fly the plane, but to win the hearts and minds of the public.
We have a few Concordes flying. We might sail...
Jean Franchi will command this historic Concorde flight.
The planes going all over the world.
During his 33 years as a test pilot, he's had little time to spare for diplomatic niceties.
So, I can't really see the point of your questions.
There are very clear procedures in place to reduce the amount of...
Brian Walpole started his flying career as an ace in the Royal Air Force aerobatics team.
There are many other aircraft, you know, which create noise. You can't fly an aircraft without creating noise, but Concorde isn't...
After British Airways bought five Concordes in 1975, it was not long before he was put in charge of the Concorde fleet.
You'll admit there's a risk?
No.
Well, we've been told that the sonic boom, for example, on landing is going to...
Yes, well, you must realise that if we did land at a sonic speed, we would have a far greater problem than noise.
Concorde seems to be polarising opinion like no other aircraft in history.
On the approach.
What about the accusation of...
False totally accusation. Where are the proofs?
No, I think we've heard that's not true at all.
Pollution in the upper atmosphere.
No.
It's been extensively tested.
With the respect, we have been told the amount of fuel...
Some newspaper stories have blamed Concorde for everything from the melting of the ice caps to the unusually cold winter of 76-77.
Drove a herd of cattle off a cliff in Switzerland in 1968.
What was the cause of the...
1968?
Concorde's just a plane for the rich, isn't it?
These people are movers and shakers. They're people who are going to bring prosperity to New York as well as to Europe.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Well done, gents.
The grilling has not been conducted by a journalist, but by a PR man from the British Airways press office.
And sorry about the lights and everything, but no. We just wanted to make it as realistic as possible for
yes.
you. Now, we think there'll be about 500 of them baying for Concorde's blood tomorrow, so...
Tomorrow's Concorde flight to New York will culminate in a huge press conference.
Easy on the references to Vietnam, things like that. Yeah. We don't want to antagonise. Although I did like the way you dealt with the red herring I threw in about the sonic boom on landing. Now, we've got a selection here of the press coverage we've been getting in advance. 1,500 cars disrupt traffic to protest at SST. SST airplane of tomorrow breaks windows, cracks walls, stampedes cattle, and will hasten the end of the American wilderness.
Goodbye.
To win over a sceptical New York public, the pilots will need every bit of help they can get.
Oh, Brian, just a word before you go. Tomorrow night is the final of the World Baseball Series, the LA Dodgers against the New York Yankees.
Right.
You can use it to break the ice.
Oh, yes, good idea.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. I'll see what I can do.
All the best to you.
All right. Thanks very much.
Lovely. Stadium over in the West Bronx tonight. It's the big one between the Yankees and the Dodgers.
Around 7.
Go Yankees!
Well, I'm having a little trouble with my car.
4,000 miles across the Atlantic, protest leader Carol Berman is making preparations to meet Concorde.
White suits for the biggest hit of the summer. It's the Bee Gees and Night Fever.
Not again. Okay, so what do you reckon, Joe? Yeah. Well, it's supposed to be touching down around 10, so if I'm with you by 6:30, is that good? Yeah, I know it's a little early, but, you know, I'm woken up super early these days anyway.
Having lost the court case, some protesters, Carol knows, are considering desperate measures to keep Concorde out of their backyards.
Well, beat this. This assemblywoman rang me yesterday. Yeah, she had this idea. We take a bunch of kites. Yeah, kites. We fly them over the landing approaches at JFK. I know, but, you know, I can't.
Across the Atlantic in Toulouse, it's the night before Concorde's maiden flight to New York. If Concorde's arrival is not met with approval, the £2 billion project will be doomed. On the morning of October the 19th, Concorde Sierra Bravo is readied for its four-hour flight. In a nearby office, Captain Franke is conducting the pre-flight briefing.
So now for the fuel flight plan. Okay, so the total is 93.5 ton. I'd like you to check on the center of gravity on the CG.
It's 93.5 tons.
The flight engineer double checks their fuel needs for the 4,000 mile trip.
We'll have a burnout of approximately a ton, which is more or less equal to what we use for taxi fuel.
Concorde's fuel tanks can hold up to 95 tons of fuel. On a full flight, this equates to almost one ton of fuel being burned per passenger. This is more than triple that of its subsonic rivals and has placed Concorde at the top of the environmentalists' blacklist. JFK Airport is surrounded by large residential areas.
We have some problems with the local population.
Concorde's battle for the hearts and minds of New Yorkers will rest above all on one thing. What disturbs them most is noise. 4,000 miles across the Atlantic, New York is 6 hours behind French time. Carol Berman has been living in her house for 22 years. When she moved here in 1955, every hour, 9 planes landed. Now, this has risen to almost 30. The prospect of supersonic planes, also using JFK, is too much for local residents and has set them on the warpath. The crew for today's flight has been chosen very carefully. 2 are French, 2 are British. They've been briefed to expect a hostile reception. If they don't present a convincing case in New York, Concorde's battle for commercial survival will be lost. Today's flight will be carrying no fare-paying passengers. It is a technical proving flight only. The crew need to convince the New York authorities that Concorde can be treated like any other commercial aircraft.
Before start, check this, please.
Master CBs, set. Cockpit.
Concorde's flight deck is crammed with the latest microchip technology.
Complete.
More than 100 items need to be checked and cross-checked before the engines can be started.
Control inverters.
On.
And anti-stall systems.
On.
Engine starting. Engines 4 and 1 starting.
Carol Berman finally sets off to organize opposition to Concorde's landing.
Blaynac, Tower, Concorde, Sierra Bravo, taxi. Roger, Sierra Bravo. Visor down, nose to 5. 3, 2, 1, now.
Rolls-Royce engines have the same power as 6,000 family cars. In the first 1,000 feet of the climb alone, a ton of fuel is used. Five minutes after takeoff, Concorde leaves to lose airspace. At 28,000 feet, The crew are ready to show why the claims that Concorde is the future of air travel should be taken seriously. Subsonic airliners reach their maximum speed at Mach 0.80, far short of the sound barrier. But Concorde is still warming up at these subsonic speeds. It's the world's only supersonic airliner. To create enough power to punch through the sound barrier, afterburners known as reheats are required. Although these use up more fuel, they increase the thrust by 25%.
Inboard reheats. Selected. Outstay. Outboard reheats. Selected. Outstay.
SSTs are killing our community.
By taking on the leadership of the anti-Concorde campaign, Carol Berman has found a suitable outlet to channel her political energies.
SSTs are not for me. Make love, not noise. No.
She and her fellow protesters have come up with a novel way of turning their cars into weapons of mass civil protest.
SSTs are not for
Carol's
me.
Placard has been left over from an organized protest she took part in at JFK 3 days before. A convoy of over 500 cars crawled around the approach roads at 5 miles an hour.
JFK, keep Concorde out at JFK! Keep Concorde out at JFK!
We'll be here until 2 o'clock. Please, you want to get the line.
This was the latest in a series of drive slows that has brought traffic using JFK to a virtual standstill. But these drive slows have done nothing to block the plans being made for Concorde's arrival. Concorde crosses into American airspace over the mid-Atlantic. The plane is famous not just for its speed, but for the extravagance of its food. Although there are no paying passengers on board, one cardinal rule is still strictly observed. The captain and co-pilot cannot be served with the same dish in case they both come down with food poisoning.
Merci.
Carol has arrived at the house of fellow protester Joseph Lewis.
If we let Concorde in, more SSTs will follow. Two, the deafening noise caused by Concorde is above the threshold of pain. Am I going too fast, Joe?
Fears about the ozone layer had not been on the agenda when Concorde was conceived in the early 1960s.
The impact of Concorde on the ozone layer has been well documented and has been proven to cause skin cancer and air pollution.
The air at 58,000 feet is crystal clear. Concorde's cruise altitude is 4 miles higher than that of any other airliner. From this vantage point over twice the height of Mount Everest, the crew has a clear view of the Earth's curve on the horizon 300 miles away. At twice the speed of sound, the serenity inside the cockpit is deceptive. At 1,300 miles an hour, Concorde is traveling 10 miles an hour faster than a speeding rifle bullet.
C'est l'heure du café, là.
You know, I was going over slogans. Make love, not noise. No, that doesn't sound right to me. SSTs are not for me.
As the leading voice against Concorde, Carol knows that every news channel in America will be lining up to interview her later this morning.
What do you think? I think that's good. Oh, wait a minute. Shh, this is it. Okay.
The plight of Carol and her neighbors has become the focus of world press attention.
And that's one of the quieter ones. 747. So, I mean, we stand there long enough, you're going to see a lot more of this and you're going to hear a lot more noise. Now, if that was the SST, forget about it. Our eardrums would pop.
To assess whether Concorde really will be as loud as its critics claim, JFK ground staff set up noise monitors around the perimeter fence. The engines are pulled back as Flight Sierra Bravo approaches New York for the first time in its career. The visor and nose are lowered to improve the pilot's visibility on the approach. It's half an hour before Concorde is due to touch down at JFK. In the corridor outside Hangar 17, security for the upcoming press conference is unprecedented. A hardcore of protesters has threatened to gatecrash the event. With hundreds of extra police drafted in for the day, Carol Berman can't get any closer than the perimeter fence.
Okay, we want a lot of noise, too.
Dozens of helicopters have been hired by journalists to give them a bird's-eye view of Concorde's landing. With Concorde just minutes away, the noise monitors are activated. If Sierra Bravo's decibel count registers too high, it may be banned from all commercial operations to JFK. Past 10 in the morning, East Coast time. By outpacing the rotation of the Earth, Concorde has in effect arrived more than 2 hours before it took off from Toulouse.
What did you think of the Concorde landing?
It was like a vulture, you know, pouring down black acrid smoke on our communities, polluting the atmosphere. It was awesome fun. It was like a big bird swooping down.
It has been a textbook flight, but the fate of the most expensive commercial aircraft ever built still hangs in the balance.
Who won the World Series?
The Yankees.
New York does not need Concorde. JFK and its residents do not need the Concorde.
While Concorde is being checked over outside, its crew confront the press in Hangar 17.
New York and for Concorde. I'm told that the New York Yankees won the World Series last night after all that they have been through. And Concorde's here today after all we've been through, and it has been a lot. New York is the city on the western side of the Atlantic for which Concorde was designed.
It's going to be devastating, devastating. This aircraft has flunked every hearing test it's had.
The opening salvo of questions does not bode well for Concorde. The
question is, does Jean Franke feel that people living around Kennedy have a right to be afraid and fear for the airplane?
If they believe what they read about it, they have a right to be afraid of. But what I question is what they read about it.
It's going to ruin our city. You know, we don't need the Concorde. JFK doesn't need the Concorde. The people of New York don't need the Concorde.
The average speed, therefore.
While the flight crew face a barrage of questions, Concorde's PR team execute their master plan to let the plane and its media critics stand face to face.
We'll stop the talking for just a few minutes until they got the airplane in and turned off the tractor. Our lovely
With many journalists awestruck by their first look at Concorde, the odds of it getting a favorable press start to shift in the aeroplane's favor.
This is just a ploy by the airlines, while the press is still interested, and it's all gonna change.
Now backed by Concorde, the mood among the flight crew becomes more confident.
Well, it's about the 600 landing I've done on the aircraft, and it looked like all the others. And the runway looked like a runway to me. And to be honest with you, with the I didn't fly a special approach for New York. I don't want to treat the people in New York any better than I treat the people in Toulouse, my hometown.
This has proven to be one of the world's noisiest aircraft, if not the noisiest.
Concorde and its crew are holding up well under press scrutiny, but it still faces one crucial test that Carol is sure will vindicate her campaign. It's takeoff.
What do you think will happen takeoff tomorrow?
I'm confident that tomorrow the noise monitors here will register very
high. The beat the meter business is not the object of the exercise. It is to satisfy the communities that we are going to be a good neighbor.
Critics accuse Concorde of having the loudest takeoff of any civilian aircraft in service. If it registers higher than the legal limit of 112 decibels, Concorde will be dragged through the American legal system for a second time. But even when Concorde's afterburners are activated, the noise monitors are not even triggered. Concorde finally passes its New York hearing test, silencing its critics. The anti-Concorde campaign may have stalled, but with all the press exposure she's gained, Carol Berman's political ambitions take off. In 1979, she's elected to the US Senate. After paying its way for 26 years on the transatlantic route, Concorde made its final landing at London Heathrow in 2003. With this revolutionary aircraft destined to become a museum exhibit, all hopes of future supersonic civilian flight remain grounded for the time being.